When I started out at Michigan about a decade ago, we set out to solve one of the most challenging problems in minimally invasive surgery. This was a problem that most people thought was unsolvable.
Minimally invasive surgery allows patients to recover faster. They get back to work faster, they have less pain after surgery, they get out of the hospital quicker. We can't give those same benefits to all patients because we haven't had the instrumentation, you know, to allow us to do that. When I was trained first in surgery, the only tools we had were tools that looked like this. These are tools that look like anything really out of your toolbox or at your home, and it required us to make big incisions in patients. A big advance came really early in my career was the advancement into minimally invasive surgery, where small ports were placed through patients and small incisions were made, and what that required was for the tools to be long.
One of the fundamental challenges in existing instruments is that it has no dexterity. So it's a tool shaft, a handle, and jaws that open and close. That's remained the paradigm.
The problem is it moves in an opposite direction of what the surgeon, his hand moves. So I can't do actually fine, delicate movements.
There's been some innovation, but one of the biggest challenges with this kind of technology is that to produce a pretty simple motion at the end effector, I have to produce a rather complicated and awkward movement on the user end, on the surgeon side. The instrument has its own universal joint. The user has their own input joint. These two joints are separated in space, and that is ultimately what leads to that awkwardness in motion. In fact, you'd see that to move the end effector up, I'm actually pointing my wrist down. And similarly, to move the end effector towards the right, I'm moving my wrist towards the left. The core innovation in this FlexDex device is this virtual center mechanism that offers a virtual center of rotation for the handle that is co-located with the user wrist. Unlike any other device, the center of rotation of the handle is located somewhere else in space, versus in this device, the center of rotation of the handle has been made to coincide with the wrist of the user. And that is accomplished via this really novel parallel kinematic mechanism that makes use of these transmission strips that capture the two rotations of the surgeon's wrist and then transmit them via cables that extend throughout the tool frame and the tool shaft to the end effector.
If I move my hand up, the device goes up, right? I'm demonstrating it by using my other hand just to show you how natural it is. If I move left, right, up, down, wherever I move my hand, the tip of this instrument moves. I'm coming into the tissue perpendicular the way we'd want to, and I'm following the curve of the needle.
In addition to this, in this device, there's yet another innovation, which is how the frame is mounted to the forearm. This is a rather unique configuration that doesn't exist in any other instrument. And here, by virtue of connecting this via a gimbal, what we do is we increase the reach of the end effector inside the patient's body in a manner that remains comfortable and ergonomic for the surgeon. Yet another innovation and capability of this device is the ability to rotate or roll infinitely. This is a very important functionality when it comes to sewing. This kind of an innovation goes well beyond applications just in surgery. This is an example of a remote control device that is done purely mechanically without the use of any robots or sensors or actuators or computers.
In 1999, the surgical robot called DaVinci came to market. And this does move like the surgeon's wrist, but it takes a $2.5 million robot on the back end to drive it. We deliver the similar intuitive control that the robot does, but without the robot.
What this does is bring robotic-like functionality to every OR, every day, any hour of the day.
It's the uniqueness of the university environment that really enabled this. The fact that we have an engineering school, a med school, and a business community in this ecosystem truly enabled the coming together of these various skills and helping translate a technology from the lab into a product.
In order to gain deeper understanding inside of the battery, we literally created a window to be able to look inside.
We call it a visualization cell, we shorten it to vis cell. The materials that are used in lithium metal batteries